Father Abraham, David John. And he's a powerful man of God. God is using him all over the world so widely. And I believe this is the season the Lord wants to talk to you. He has a plan for you. And he loves to tell his message to you. And enjoy the presence of God. Listen to God's word that can change our lives. And this may be the time you experience a special anointing of the Holy Spirit. And God doing a miracle. Our God is a God of miracle. Believe Jesus loves you.
Turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 15. The book of Acts, chapter 15, verses 15. From 15 to verse 20. If you can read it together along with me, it will be very nice. If you don't have a Bible, you can look at the screen. Next time when you come to the church, you can bring your own Bible. I would always recommend you to bring your Bible, a hard copy, not your mobile app. If you have got if you are seeing your Bible in the app, if you have only the Bible app in your phone, you can use that phone. How? You have got a phone, you are seeing the scripture on the phone. If you have got only Bible app in the phone, then you are able to take and read it. Otherwise, put the phone down, you can see this, okay? Because when you take the phone, one WhatsApp notification will come, one Facebook notification will come, one SMS will come, then I will lose you. You may be sitting here personally, but I will completely lose you. I don't want to lose you. You have taken your time to come on a Friday evening to listen to the Word of God. I want that to be beneficial to you. Amen? It may be a little hard, but that's what will change you. If I don't offend you, how will you change? You will think what you are doing is right. Okay, let the Word of God speak to you. Should we all rise to our feet and then read these verses together? Acts chapter 15, verse 15. Let's read. And with the words of the prophets agree, just as it is written, after this I will return and will rebuild the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. I will rebuild its ruins and I will set it up, so that the rest of the mankind may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles who are called by my name, says the Lord, who does all these things, known to God from eternity are all his words. Therefore, I judge that we should not trouble those from among the Gentiles who are turning to God, but that we write to them to abstain from things polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from things strangled, and from blood. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your grace, we pray for your mercy. Lord, you will speak to us. We are not here to hear a man speaking, but from you, O God. 10,000 words of mine cannot do anything, but one word from you will change for eternity. So pray, O Lord, you will speak to us. Here we are, willing to listen, O Lord. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. God is prophesying that he is going to rebuild the tabernacle of David. This is the quote from Amos chapter 9, verse 11 onwards. Exactly that's what repeated in the book of Acts chapter 15, which is the Jerusalem Council, which is coming together to speak about how the non-Jewish people coming into the faith should behave or to live their life. Right from the beginning, God created mankind so that he can have fellowship with a man. The reason God created Adam and Eve so that he can dwell with them and they can dwell with them and they can have a fellowship with one another, and that's the idea in which God has created human being. In Genesis chapter 3 verse 8 we see the fellowship was broken when Adam sinned. When God came, he was hiding from the presence of God. The sin has separated man and God. That is why he lost to live in the glory realm, but he came into the physical realm. As you read in Romans chapter 3 verse 23, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That is, the glory is the manifested presence of God which can be sensed in our senses. We have, as Adam has failed, so the all mankind has fallen short of the glory of God. We are to live in the glory of God. We have failed from to live in the presence, so we have dropped so badly where we were supposed to live with God. The Adam sin, we have fallen short of the glory. Thank God, Jesus came and he died on the cross and he has taken us to the glory realm, but we are yet not in the full glory. As Colossians chapter 1, 27 says, Christ is in you, the hope of the glory of God. So that when Christ comes inside of you, we are being taken into the glory realm. The fall may be from there to down, but then Christ is taking us. That's why is 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18 says that we have with the unveiled face, we have been transformed from one glory to another form of glory. So we have to transform our mind and we got to transform ourselves to move in the glory realm and to live in the presence of God. That is what God's intended purpose is. That's why he has created us. That's why we are here. But being a Christian, you become the carrier and of the presence of God. You are not a stranger to the presence of God. You become the carrier of the presence of God. But unfortunately, we are so much into doing search, we lost the sense of who God is and where God is. People today, you ask someone, where God is, there are people say, when I go to the church, when they sing the two songs, and the third song, when they talk about the Spirit, come, immediately I feel the presence, brother. What? When the worship leader leads you, come, let's all open our mouth and say, praise the Lord. Oh, today I felt so good, brother. Sister, today you did the worship. I felt such a presence. Hello, there is no on-off switch. There is no on-off switch in here. As soon as you come inside the church, okay, turn it on. Holy Spirit, come. When I go out, attack, off. You are a Christian 24/7. It's not that, you know, the problem is, we have got so much of traditions. So, we think God is here. God is here in this building, so I have to come. The people have misplaced so much, they think only in the church God lives. You may be looking very holy. You may know your Bibles. You may know your scriptures. But still, what you will say? When pastor comes and lays his hands on me, oh, I felt the presence. Thank you, pastor. God's intended purpose is that he wants to live with you. In John 14:16, he said, the Holy Spirit will live with you forever. He will live with you forever. The very reason God created a church or a tabernacle is to dwell among the people. When the Israelites been slaves for 430 years, he uses Moses to bring them through the wilderness. When they come through the wilderness, what happens? God tells them that you make a tabernacle. You make a tabernacle. You read from Exodus chapter 25 to chapter 40, God says, that I will show you the model, you do it exactly as per the measurement. He gives the measurement of every pole, every length, every, you know, fabric, the color, the metals to be used, every single detail he gives. He gives even the garment detail for the priest, even their undergarments has been prescribed very clearly. Because God is so particular that he gives a thing, but he tells you why it is being prepared. In Exodus chapter 25 verse 8, he says that you make a sanctuary for me so that I may dwell with them. Because I want you to prepare this tabernacle, the sanctuary of God. The reason is I want to dwell with them. I don't want to be directing from somewhere alone. I don't want to be there up in heaven. I want to be with them because I want to dwell with them. These are the people I have chosen. I have formed them. I have created them. And I want to guide them. How do I guide them? You prepare a sanctuary. You prepare this tabernacle and I will guide them. How? I will guide them as a pillar of clouds in the morning and I will kill pillar of fire, cloud of fire in the night, so that they know that I dwell among them. All the outside people, all the other nations, non-Israelites people, were terrified of this God. Because who is this people? They have got such a protection. During the day, there is a cloud that's hovering over them. It is protecting them. In the night, there is a fire. Oh, what a big God. But the people who lives underneath, they were murmuring and complaining. What is this, Lord? You are giving only manna. Manna idli, manna dosa, manna biryani. Nothing else. Why can't we have? Remember, in Egypt, we had cucumber. We had garlic. You know, in Ernakulam, we used to have that roti and beef fry, beef pepper fry, so good. Here in America, Michigan is always cold. There, you know, we go in the boat, catch the fish, fry that fish, that vanjiram, yathra nalla undu. Here we come and find it so difficult, brother. We always sit here and cry about the past. Where did we learn? We learned from the Bible only. Yeah, the Israelites, they're being slave. They've been brought by God supernaturally and his protection is there. And God has brought you from India and he has kept you here for a purpose. Wherever you are born, he has brought you here and he has planted you here. But you will be sitting and still thinking about not paratha curry, koli curry, meen curry. I really wonder how God will look at us and how his God will grieve the way we murmur and complain. The way we complain, we murmur. What is that you have done? What is that you are so special? God has brought you here. What is that? There's nothing good dwells in me. Yet God chose me. God picked each and every one of you wherever you were. And yet he has chosen you, he has anointed you, he has forgiven you, he has put his spirit in you and he has brought you here. But you failed to recognize. That's what the Israelites failed to recognize. And God told them. And then when they come to the land of Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, you find a book in your Bible called Deuteronomy. I can summarize the book in two lines. That's a series of sermon preached by Moses before they are entering into Canaan. All he said is, you are going to go to the land where everything is going to be so natural, but all are supernatural by God. You are going to eat which you have not planted. You are going to live a house which you have not built. You are going to enjoy the things which you have never worked for. All these things will happen to you so naturally, but don't think it's because of you or your power has got you this wealth, but it is God who has done this for you. Same way, it applies to us also. Today, we are all here. Do not think that you are so qualified, that's why God has brought you here. You got a job because of your qualification, because of your ability, and because of that you have got a good house or a car, whatever. It's all because of God's pure grace. Nothing else. It's all because of Him. If you think that it is your ability, it is your thing, then you are grossly mistaken. Because God has got a purpose, that's why He brought you here. We fail to recognize that purpose, we fail to see that purpose, but what we see? Ourselves. How big I am, you know? What position I hold, you know? No, nothing. Without God, we are zero. Please understand that. And they have come to Canaan. What did they do? They forgot God. God preached, used Moses, don't forget. The Bible, it says, fear not. What do we do? Do not worry about tomorrow. Lord, that's our main worry. Do not worry about tomorrow. That is the only worry we have, Lord. He says, seek the first the kingdom of God and all these things we will add to you. What we will do? We will seek all the things and then we will add God to it. I always make a joke of this. Just for a moment, rewind your prayer and see. First of all, many of you don't have time only to pray. And then you will say, God understands. No, brother. He knows how busy I am. You are ready to leave the house and then only your wife will say, we didn't pray. Oh, okay. Make a short prayer. Lord, my husband is going. Go with him. Protect him. My children are going to school. Go with them. Protect them. Look after them. I am going. Put the angels before and behind my car. Protect my car. I put the blood of Jesus on it. Lord, we are leaving the house and going. Make sure there are some angels. Put a fire around the house. You protect the house. And everything you take care. Okay? In Jesus' name, Amen. Who is the servant? Who is the master here in this prayer? Hello? Some of you are wondering, how come he is selling my prayer? That is copyrighted prayer. Just for a moment you think, what was your prayer? What was your prayer yesterday? If you had prayed. You always tell, you command God to do this. But then you will come and say, it not my will, Lord, your will be done, O Lord. I surrender all, Lord. But then I won't surrender, Lord. And they lost it. And they lost it so badly. God has to send so many troubles and trials to get their attention. Finally, they rejected God by rejecting Samuel. And they wanted a king. And just before that, all the enemies, the nations of Philistines and Amalekites and everyone knew, they have got a box. The Israelites have got a box. The Ark of the Covenant means it's a box. Ark means box, okay? Now, because we have got a lot of, spiritual lingos. People think Pentecostal. Oh, brother. No, Pentecostal means 50. That's all, okay? Catholic. Oh, yo. No, Catholic means universal. You understand the meanings of it, okay? So people don't get attached to the lingos. And these guys, what they do, Philistines, they see the Israelites are doing very well because they have got a box. They didn't realize it is the presence of God. Because the Ark of the Covenant, God gives a specification. 42 inch long, 27 inch width, and 20 inch depth, covered with the gold. And inside, two parts of manna and Aaron's rod and the two tablets of stone with the 10 commandments. And above that, there is a two archangels. They are facing each other and in that mercy seat, that's where they have to put the blood on it for the punishment of sin to be delayed for a year. And this box is the one which is helping them. So they wanted to take that box. You will find in your book in 2 Samuel chapter 4, they come and they take the box. They take the box and Eli hears the box, and then Eli dies. And his son Pinehas has also died. His daughter-in-law gives birth, and then she names the child as Ichabod. Ichabod means the glory of the Lord departed. That is, the presence of the Lord has gone away from Israelites. And they didn't do anything about it. The Philistines take it to their home, and then they put it near their God. Their God falls down. The next day their God breaks his legs and feet, and then they find everyone is getting some sores. So they said, okay, we will send it to the next town. The next town also get the, say, they all get the sores. Immediately they say, we will send it to the next. They say, no, don't send that box. We don't want that box. They decide to send it to Kerith Jaram. It comes to Kerith Jaram and it remains there. Saul becomes a king. Saul doesn't bother about the presence of the Lord. Then David's become a king. You will find in 2 Samuel chapter 5, David becomes the king of whole Israel. As soon as he becomes the king of whole Israel, the first thing he looks for is, where is the presence of God? He looks for, where is the presence of God? Then they say, the Ark of the Covenant in Kerith Jaram. So, let's get it. You will remember this name, Uzzah, who touched the Ark of the Covenant, he died. Yeah, that you will find in 2 Samuel 6. You know, you will remember all the wrong things. And he brought the Ark in a wrong way. He brought it in a puller cart. That's why he died. And then he do it in the proper way. He brings the Ark of the Covenant inside the temple. He brings into Jerusalem. A lot of people say David danced in the presence of God. David never danced inside the synagogue or inside the church building. He danced on the roadside. Because today, these days, there is something called worship has gone completely haywire. People are singing, dancing, and doing breakdance and all those kind of things. David never danced inside the church. Please go home and study your scriptures. Any worship, it has got to be done to bring the awe of God. You will find the word worship the first time in your Bible in Genesis chapter 22. When Abraham goes up to Mount Moriah to offer his son as a sacrifice, that he calls his worship. You bring the sacrifice of praises, that is worship. Not jumping and dancing, doing breakdance and doing all kinds of nonsense is not worship. Please understand that. I know we are get excited, we lift our hands, we clap our hands. It's okay, fine. But doing kind of a dance and all those things, that doesn't bring glory to God. I know some of you may be worried, you know, you may be thinking, yeah, this guy may be a typical old Indian. No, I live in London. I am also modern, okay? I have two boys, my elder son is 26, so I know what I am talking. When you do worship, it has to bring the fear of God. What a great big God we serve. What a great big God we have. You know, that's what is worship is all about. Not, you know, dancing and jumping and doing all those things. It's okay. But then you need to see whether what you do bring the fear of God or not. That is the real worship. And David brings up and then he puts the ark and then he tells one thing. Go and offer sacrifices to God in the evening and in the morning. Here is a difficulty. In the sanctuary, what God told Moses, that I want to dwell with them, he gave three parts, the outer court, inner court, and the most holy place. The outer court, we all can go in. The inner court, only the priest can go. The most holy place, only the high priest can go. And that high priest can go only once a year. And that high priest, first he needs to take a sacrifices of blood for his sins, then the sins of the people. The sin offering, what he takes it for himself, if it's not right, then he will be killed there in the presence of God. So what do? They tie a rope with a bell on the rope, leave the rope outside, and then the high priest goes inside. Why? In case if he is dead inside, if someone goes inside to pick him up, he will also dead. So the pastor goes inside, the high priest pastor goes inside, and then he is offering the blood sacrifice and everything. If the bell is ringing, he is alive. Otherwise, oh, he is gone. Come on, assistant pastor will pull the rope. Nowadays, without that itself, assistant pastor pulls the rope. That is a different story. But now, David says, go and do the worship. Imagine if you were a priest. If you go and worship the Lord in the evening, you are going to be dead. And David gives the instruction, go and worship the Lord. And you are not supposed to go into the presence of God except the high priest. And he says, go. If you don't go, David is going to kill you. If you go, God is going to kill you. Imagine the problem the priest facing. What they do, they go and offer sacrifice and sing songs to God. And God does not kill the priest. They start going and worshiping God morning and evening, every day. For 30 long years during the time of David, before and after, it didn't happen. They did that. When David built a house for him, he says, how can this God cannot be on this place? We need to build a house of God. God says, no, you won't build it. Only your son will build it. Solomon will build it. So Solomon builds the temple and then he dedicates the temple. Okay, I want you to see a verse. Come to 1 Kings chapter 8. Solomon dedicates the temple and here he gives the thing. Verse 15. 1 Kings chapter 8 verse 15. And Solomon said, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, who spoke with his mouth to my father David, and with his hand he has fulfilled the saying. Since the day that I brought my people Israel out of Egypt, I have chosen no city from any tribe of Israel in which to build a house, that my name might be there, but I chose David to be over my people Israel. Now it was in the heart of my father David to build a temple for the name of the Lord God of Israel. Listen very carefully, my dear brothers and sisters. It was in the heart of my father David. God never chose a city, God never chose anyone. God's idea is David. God's idea is not a city. God's idea is not a temple. God's idea is not any tribe. God's idea is a man who's after his heart. God's idea is David. It is not a city. It is not a tribe. It is not a place. It's not God's idea. He chose David, but it was in David's heart to build a temple for God. And God looks at the heart of David and he says, yes, he has thought it, so I will do it. The God who fills the whole universe comes down and lives inside the temple because of David.
Can you imagine? The God who fills the whole universe, His presence cannot be contained in the whole universe. He chose to come down and live inside a temple because of a man who has God in his heart. I want to build a temple for God. He comes himself, he makes himself available in that particular place. So the God comes and lives inside the temple. The temple construction which Solomon constructed is one of the amazing construction. It took about 7 years with so many laborers and such an amazing construction which was built. But that was idea of David, not God. That's why David was able to say, delight in the Lord your God who grants the desires of your heart. Because if you delight in God, He will fulfill your desires. Because what was His desire? His desire is, I want to be with God. I want to see His presence. I am not worried about the laws and bylaws, and I want God's presence. And he did that, and God allowed him. They built a temple, and God was there. But people again forget. People go away from God. God has to raise a Babylonian. And the Babylonian invaded Jerusalem. They demolished the temple. And then God raises up Darius. And Darius and Cyrus, they send the people back. Ezra and Nehemiah, they come back. They repair the walls. They repair the temple. Again, the worship starts. Then Jesus comes in. When Jesus comes in, and Jesus tells him in John chapter 4, with a Samaritan woman, when they were talking about water, they end up talking about worship. You say we worship in this mountain. We worship in this mountain. But Jesus says in John 4:23-24, there is a time coming and the time is now. Those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. That's what the worship is. It's not about the place. It's not about the location. It's about how you are worshiping Him in spirit and truth. And then before dying in Matthew 25, Jesus prophesies, this temple, there will not be one brick above another brick. Literally, that was fulfilled. When the Romans invaded Jerusalem, they put a fire on the temple. And Solomon built it with so much of gold. In the fire, all the gold melted and went through all the bricks. It went inside the gap of the bricks. So they have to sit and separate every brick to remove the gold from inside. Literally fulfilled the prophecy. So the temple has been demolished. No more temple. And before that, what happened? On the cross, when Jesus was dying on the cross, He cried out and He gave up the Holy Spirit. At that time, there was an earthquake. And the temple curtain, which was separating God and the people, was torn from top to bottom. Not from bottom to top, top to bottom. Because God tore open the curtain because the blood sacrifice was done. I am no longer live here. I am going to live with the people. So the curtain was open and no longer the temple was there. God wasn't there. And then literally 70 AD, the Jerusalem temple was completely demolished. There is no temple. And now, in Acts chapter 15, they are saying, God is going to raise up the tabernacle of David. Not the tabernacle what Moses, God gave so much of detail. Not that tabernacle. Not that magnificent temple what Solomon built. But there is nothing, just the Ark of the Covenant, where the presence of God was there, that I am going to restore. Why? I gave you this introduction so that I can preach my message. Why would God do that? You may be a Christian for
10 years, 20 years, 30 years, or maybe you are born in this church, you are brought up in this church. There are a lot of people think that God lives here. Lots of them. They think God is here in this church. I'm so sorry to disappoint you. God lives everywhere. He lives here. He lives in when you go in your car. He lives in your home. He lives inside of you. He lives everywhere. You know why this is so important? I'm preaching this message. For revival, you need to realize God is not here. God is everywhere. Because when you fight with your husband and wife, when you have an argument at home, when you have got a problem with somebody, you think God is here, so I can do everything there. Hello? Imagine, your pastor visits your home. How would you behave in front of your pastor? Will you argue with each other? Even if you were fighting, as soon as the pastor comes, he will say, "Honey, can I help you? Can I take the bottle?" Maybe you've been fighting so long, tooth and nail, but then when the pastor comes, you will say, you will put up an act because you want to show that you are so lovey-dovey. As soon as the pastor goes, he will pick where you left. You fear a man, you don't fear God. Why? Hello? Say for example, two of you fighting, we will put you here. How will you fight? Both of you will argue in front of the church. No, yeah. How will we fight, Pastor? Everybody is watching now. You are worried about these people, you are not worried about God. Why is that? Hello? Why is that? Because you didn't understand the concept where God lives. You failed, miserably failed, the Christians miserably failed to understand where the presence of God is. You come to church, you study the Bible, you pray, you do everything, but you fail to recognize that God lives inside of you. And wherever you go, He is there. Whatever you do, He is there. He doesn't go away from you. My church, He is with you always. You may not sense His presence when there is a sin in you. You may not sense His presence when you have gone away from the Lord, but God is always with you. He doesn't go away. Don't ever think that God lives inside the church. Because that is the problem. We have got so much of traditions going on. Mark 7:13. Could you just display it, brother? Mark 7:13. Because we have got so much of traditions, because of the traditions, the word of God could not take its place and it is not able to do in its purposes. You are invalidating the word of God by your tradition, which you have been handed down, and you do many things as that. You know, I used to be before knowing God, I used to serve in an Anglican church as a pastorate committee member. I'm one of the guy who vehemently argued that no one should wear a shoe when they come here. Hello? I was fighting. Nobody can come in this place with a shoe because God lives here. That is why I used to come to church on Sunday morning and I was thinking God must be very pleased Abraham has come to see him. When I leave, I go have a drink, eat, then go home and sleep. That's how I was living as my Christian life. I was thinking I am a Christian, but I wasn't. I have nothing to do with Christianity. I have nothing to do with Christian. Nothing to do with Jesus Christ. But I was thinking because the traditions which was handed down to me. You come to church, you make a prayer. Where is God? Oh, immediately some of you will raise your voice. Oh, Heavenly Father. Because you want to hear heaven should hear your praise. You think God is in heaven, so you need to raise your voice. Yeah. God can hear a small, still voice. Psalm 139 says, even before the word comes out of my mouth, he knows it. Some of you ask you to pray, they will pray only in King James. Authorized version prayer. O thee, thy, thou. We also don't understand. Thus saith the Lord, I will go before thee. Hello? Why don't you talk normal? As long as you were talking normal, immediately they will change the tone, they will change everything. Why? Because we don't renew our mind. So today I want to talk only one simple message I want to take with you. God does not live here in the church. God lives inside of you. Tell your neighbor, God lives inside of you. Come on. It's okay. Look at your neighbor and say, come on. Okay, now you tell your neighbor, God lives inside of me. What happens? The Holy Spirit left, God left from the temple, and then in Acts chapter 2, on the 50th day, the Holy Spirit poured out upon all the people, and God took a new residence, that is me, you, every one of you. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in? Hello? Now, anyone wants to come into the presence of God, where they have to come? They have to come to me. They have to come to you. When you go to your office, people will have to see Christ in you. Your children will have to say, you want to see Jesus Christ? Come to my home. Some of you are getting scared. I hope my children won't say that, you know. No, they should be able to say, you come, you have a look at, you talk to my mom, you talk to my dad, you can see Christ in them. Your husband will have to testify, you want to see Jesus Christ? Come talk to my wife, you will see Christ. Your wife will testify, you want to see Jesus? Talk to my husband. I hope your journey back home will be peaceful. You know, some of you are really getting terrified. I could see the because we did not know, and we were thinking, even though we know this verse, we were thinking that God lives in heaven. We know the verse, we know the Bible, we know the Holy Spirit. That is why when you come inside the church, when they sing 2-3 songs, when they put the fourth, the last song, little fast song, then only, yeah. I can feel it. You know, some of them are saved from Hindu background. So they will start the music slowly. And the last song, they will increase the beat, the drum beat. Dun, 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 dun. So immediately, so we are being saved now, we have come to church. We also have the same attitude. The last song, put it, brother. Put it, brother. Brother, put it on that gear. Yeah. Now I feel it. Hello? He's always with you. You are the temple. You should be able to say, you want to see Jesus? Come talk to me. You know, in John 14, when Philip asked Jesus, Jesus, so was the Father. What was Jesus' reply? If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. You should be able to say, have you talked to me? That means you have seen Jesus Christ. In your workplace. You know, many people think that only pastor has got a responsibility. In your workplace is the mission field. God has sent you as a missionary. You are here because God has brought you as a reverse missionary to this nation. Once this nation sent the gospel to us today, it is our responsibility to evangelize and preach to these people. They people need Jesus today. That is why you are here. Not for us to come together, eat rice and fish curry and say good things to each other and then fight with each other and then go away. But I'm telling you, because why? You don't have the sense that you are the temple of God. That's the reason. You know, if you know that you are the one, you are carrying the presence of God, and anyone who go wherever I go, I am carrying the presence of God in the midst of God's presence, nobody will remain the same. Nobody could die when Jesus was there. Even the dead people rose to life again. No lame people could be there that way. Every one of them got healed. Their life has been set free. Whether they are a prostitute or a lame man or a blind, everyone, their life got changed. Then it should happen to you. Wherever you go, in your workplace, in your home, everywhere, that you have to carry the presence of God and you have to release the presence of God wherever you go. That is why God has anointed you. That's why God has given you the Holy Spirit. Not for you to feel good. You have to change. That is why God has anointed you. The Holy Spirit is not for feel good. It is for to change. There are so many people perishing. They are going to hell. My brothers and sisters, it should bother you. It should, you know, you should have the heart of God to feel, you know, no one should perish. That is His will. He died so that with that you can save people. People can come to know the saving faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you don't do that, how are we going to? You know, in same 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20, there's another thing. There is another facet of this verse is there. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, is in you, whom from God, and you are not your own. You are not your own. But we find it very, very difficult to accept this. Let me ask you this question. Did you plan to come to this earth on your own? No. Your mom and dad gave you the life. Who gave you the name? Your mom and dad. So the name is not your own. You didn't come on your own. Who gave you the education? Parents gave you the education. Who gives you the salary? You don't know. Somebody, some owner, but it is ultimately from God. Do you know when you are going to die? You don't know. You know who is going to bury you? You don't know. But you act as if you are in charge of the life. Yeah. You don't know how you came. You don't know how you are going to go. You don't know when you came. By others telling you know. But you don't know when you are going to go also. Yeah. You don't know. It is going to come. One day it's going to come. You don't know when is the day. There's a very well-built athletic guy who's doing everything right. He was only 41 years old. And I've shared the gospel, but he was, yes, no, he was there. And he was inviting me to come and play because I need to do something to lose my weight and all those things. But he was so bent upon practicing and everything. One day evening, 3 months back, he went to play volleyball and he had a fall down in the court. He died on the spot. Just 42 years old, well built, athletic. No complaints, no sugar, no nothing. Hale and healthy. Drop dead. Boom, gone. You don't know when you are going to go. You are not your own. You have been bought at a price. My church, God poured out His blood to buy you. It costed everything for God. He was on the cross. He saw, if I don't die, Abraham will go to hell. So He chose to die for me. He chose to die for you.
He chose to die for each and every one of you. You can't live for yourself. 2 Corinthians 5:15 says, you cannot live for yourself. The one who lives should live for the one who died for you. Because he has given you the life. And you are not your own. So you are carrying the presence of God and you become the temple of God. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. So you got to carry wherever the presence of God, wherever you go, you carry the presence of God. People will have to come to know God through you. Because the Spirit of God wants to do things with you, through you. Because he is inside of you. Let your mind be renewed. Let the old thing go away. You are the temple. People, if they want to see Jesus, they have to come to you. You should be able to show, I will open up my life to you. You can come. You can come and see Jesus in me. Occasionally you may fail. Occasionally you may fail. The righteous may fall 7 times. It's okay. But then you need to know how quickly you get up and connect with God. That's what makes a Christian. Who's a Christian? How much he falls, how quickly he gets up and then connects with God. I'm sorry, Lord. I cleanse myself. I confess my sins and I'm sorry. I want to ride with you. I give this example only by 2 animals. One is the pig, the another one is the cat. How much ever you wash and put soap and shampoo and perfume and everything, as soon as the pig sees a ditch, it runs and it falls down and enjoys the dirt. But the cat occasionally falls into the ditch. Immediately, it jumps out. And then what it does? Starts cleanses by its, starts licking. It uses its mouth, cleanses, it licks and cleanses. A Christian should be able to understand, immediately confess, use your tongue, confess with God. As 1 John 1:7 says that if you confess your sins, he is able to forgive all your sins. How many times? It doesn't matter. Confess your sins and make right with God. Your topmost priority should be, I am the temple of God. I have to glorify God through my body, my spirit, in my soul, that I have to glorify God. So I have to glorify God in this body. So this is the temple. I have to look after this temple. And I have to make sure that there is nothing in between me and God. So that this become the holy temple. I am the holy person because the Holy Spirit lives inside of me. So I have a responsibility to carry the presence of God. And I can't take it lightly. Because God depends on me. His presence lives inside of me. The God of the universe, the God who created everything, the God who omnipotent, omnipresent God decides to come and live inside of me as an unworthy person. So I have got a great responsibility because I am the temple of God and I have to realize that. Not going to Jerusalem. Nowadays, there is one big fashion. People all start going to Jerusalem. I'm going to see. I got so annoyed when I saw one of the minister of God standing inside the Jesus tomb. And he says, such a presence of God here. I don't want to come out of it only here, so much a present. I said, Jesus could not stay there. Close the tomb. Let him die there only. For a wrong teaching. Jesus could not stay in the tomb for more than 3 days. Why are you going and misleading the people? I see such a presence of God here. Nonsense. You know, because people make all this kind of, you know, don't believe anything, everything. Check with the word of God. God says you are the temple. Why you have to go to somewhere else to see the temple? Oh, brother, then why am I coming to the church? You are coming to the church so that you can encourage one another. You can pray for one another. We can help you to grow in the Lord Jesus Christ. You will come to know God in a new dimension so that you can serve one another. You can pray for one another. You can help one another. You can encourage one another. This one another appears in New Testament 157 times.
That's why we come to the church. We are connected because we are connected to Christ. You and me are brothers and sisters because of the blood of Jesus Christ. You may born different place. You may born brought up in a different place. You may not look like me. You may not talk like me. You may not eat like me. You may not be like, no way you may be like me. But you and me are connected to one family because of Jesus. Because of the blood. We are blood brothers and sisters. That's why we come to the church. I want to come and I want to serve one another. People don't realize that. You come to church. Why? Let me give you a simple illustration. 5 minutes. I have time. Okay. This hand is exactly opposite of this hand. When there is something hits this hand, when it pains, immediately this hand comes and holds. Not because they are together. Not because these hands are coming together. It is because this hand is perfectly connected to my head. Same way, this hand is perfectly connected to my head. If you are not able to feel the pain of someone else in this congregation, check whether you are connected with Christ. If it doesn't burden you, when someone is going through some difficulty, if someone is going through some pain, if it doesn't bother you, check, are you living in Christ? Are you connected with Christ? If you are connected with Christ, definitely you will feel the pain. You will not sit and talk ill about that. That means you are connected with some other body. That sister, she's so good, but that means it's gone. Oh, that brother is very good. He really runs a very good worship. He runs a Bible study. Yeah, he's doing everything good, brother, but finished. The but means but only. How many times we speak ill? Will any one of you say, this hand is very bad, brother? It is so dirty. Do you abuse your body that way? No, you don't. But how come you are abusing one another, fellow brothers and sisters in the church? How easily we make a fool of ourselves? Because you don't know how well you are connected to Christ. If you are connected to Christ, if you are in this body, this is the local body, and you are part of the global body. Church is one, not this church. Church is one. Church of Christ is only one. You don't find a denomination. It's okay. Let's not go into that. But what I'm saying is, if you are in part of this global body church, then you ought to be connected with Christ. Then you will cry out for one another. You look out for one another because you are the temple of the living God. You don't have to go to the temple. You don't have to go to Jerusalem. You don't have to come to this temple. You are the temple. And people who see you, they have to see Christ in you. Then only the revival will come. You can pray, God send us a revival, send us a revival. God said, I'm going to rebuild the temple or the tabernacle of David, which is in ruins. Whatever ruin you are in today, God can rebuild you. You may be ruined. You may be going through problems. You may be in sin. Or you may be living which is not pleasing in the sight of God. Today, you can surrender to God. God can rebuild. God will rebuild it to you. If your heart's desire, Lord, I want to be used. And I have understood, I am the temple of the living God. God, I don't want to settle for anything else. I am not looking for some blessing. I am not looking for something else. I want your presence. I want to be right with you. More than anything else, I want to be right with you. That is my heart's desire. That is all I want. If this is what you are, this is what you are plea, I want you to stand wherever you are. I don't want you to close your eyes. I'm not going to do any magic or anything. If you are very honest before God, yes, I want to understand. I am the temple of God.
And I want His presence to fill me. And people who see me, they have to see the presence of God in me. They have to see Christ in me. This is my heart's desire. My temple may be in ruins, but God, today I commit myself to You. Rebuild me. Rebuild me, O Lord. I want to be right with You. If this is what Your heart's desire, if this is what Your cry of Your heart, wherever you are, I want you to stand. And I will pray for you. Let's close our eyes for a moment. Let the presence of God minister to us. Let the Holy Spirit minister to each and every one of you. What is the ruins you are in? What is the things you need to confess? The areas in which you need to confess, you want God to make it right. My brothers and sisters, in Romans chapter 5 verse 6 says, while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8 says, while yet we were without strength, Christ died for us. Romans 5:10 says, while we were still enemies of God, Christ died for us. You can be any one of this category, but today you can be made right with God. All you need to do is, sorry Lord, this I shouldn't have done. Sorry Lord, I shouldn't have treated my wife like this. Sorry Lord, I shouldn't have treated my husband like this. Sorry Lord, I shouldn't have treated my children like this. Sorry Lord, I shouldn't have treated my parents like this. Sorry Lord, I shouldn't have treated my employees or my boss or my manager, or I shouldn't have treated this way, and I want to repent of that sin. God, make it all right. God, rebuild me. God, once again, O Lord, put the joy of salvation in me, O Lord. Today I want to be born again today. Lord, as a fresh, a newborn baby, I want to be born again today, O Lord. Today put a new, fresh anointing upon me for me to know that I am the temple of the living God. The Holy Spirit lives inside of me. I have been bought at a price. God, you shed your blood for me so that I can be bought. God, you have bought. I am your property, O Lord. I belong to you, O Lord. So today, O God, let the Holy Spirit pour out upon me, O Lord. Fill me with the new anointing, O Lord. I want to be the temple of the living God, O Lord. The people who see me, let them see Christ in me, O Lord. Open your mouth and speak to God. Confess whatever sins you are in. Today, confess. Make it so that you can be made right with God. So the revival can start with you. The revival can start from this building. The revival can start with this church. But it all starts with you. You alone. Make a confession. Take a time. Make a confession and pray to God. So that God today, God can rebuild you. God can refresh you. God can renew you. Every old thing be gone. Let the new thing be come. Oh, behold, all the old things passed away. Behold, I'm making everything new. God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for each and every one of my brothers and sisters here, O Lord.